The land below many major US cities is sinking. Regions of the Atlantic coast could be sinking by up to 5 millimeters annually.
This phenomenon, known as land subsidence, where land is sinking, impacts the oil-rich Gulf Coast, the agricultural hub of California, and many other places across the US.
Coastal counties produce $10 trillion in goods and services, employ 54.6 million people, and pay $4 trillion in wages. So about 35% of the U.S. GDP is at risk.
Whether it's the oil industry down south or all of our ports, which facilitate so much business and commerce in this region, we have to consider that this is something that's happening, and happening in conjunction with other threats.
Combine that with sea level rise and the fact that almost 40% of the population resides in coastal counties, the U.S. has an expensive and dangerous problem.
From perspective of a person standing on the land, it does not matter. Land goes down or sea level goes up. And in many places, land subsidence rate is orders of magnitude faster than sea level rise.
The value of the average Californian home experiencing land subsidence has decreased by 6%.
The good news is, unlike many climate hazards, this one we can do something about right now.
It's not cheap and it's not easy, but we have tools in our toolbox that can implement that and see the results in a short period of time. I'm talking about months to years.
Which U.S. cities are sinking the fastest, and what does that mean for the residents and the national economy?
A majority of the U.S. cities are affected by a certain level of land subsidence. However, some of them experience some of the fastest rates that you can imagine. For example, Port Arthur and New Orleans and Biloxi along the Gulf Coast of the United States experience rate as fast as 1 centimeter per year, which is considered to be extremely fast for a city. And along the East Coast of the United States, we have Chesapeake Bay, Hampton Road area, but also Charleston. They experience some of the fastest rates. And on the West Coast of the United States, some of the cities in California, such as Foster City, experience some of the fastest rate of land subsidence.
This can be problematic for our infrastructure.
A lot of the things that we built were built to be on steady ground that doesn't shift. So if you think of something like a rail line, and the rail line's running across ground that's sinking, some of that will sink, some of it will not. So now you might have kind of erosion beneath the track where you didn't have it before. You might have to realign the tracks. You might have to regrade things. You might have to continually add land back where it's sinking.
High-speed trains. A tiny land subsidence can be deadly, but for some infrastructures, millimeter to centimeter of the land subsidence probably would be okay. Majority of the infrastructure that are at risk includes airports, but also linear infrastructure, such as railways and pipelines. Ports and harbors are significantly affected, and also highways.
Land subsidence can also have an impact on home values.
It could be that a buyer comes in and sees the obvious cracks and all those things, and they are willing to pay less. But also it could be that there is less jobs because of all the overextraction and less economic activity. Or it could be that your private wells are going dry.
Professor Namati's research on the Central Valley of California found that on average, home values decreased by 8.1% if they were located in a high subsidence area. He said he's confident extrapolating that data across the U.S.
There are a few reasons for land subsidence, some due to human activities and others are natural.
One of the main reasons why land is sinking is completely out of our control, and it has to do with a rebound from the Ice Age when glaciers were on land.
And as a result of removal of that giant mass, land is rising in Canada, for example. And in the perimeter of that, land is falling, which includes, for example, East Coast of the United States. The other natural driver of the land elevation change is tectonic processes. For example, earthquakes can make the land rise, but also in some places to fall. So these two are considered to be natural processes, but we have a lot of processes that are made by human.
The other reasons relate to how we've developed our cities.
Land is being compacted because we're removing groundwater. We use groundwater to drink and for other purposes. And as we take water out from the land, the space beneath it becomes compact because we've built on top of it. Another reason why land is sinking is because we put very heavy things like buildings on land, and that's starting to compact as well.
The infrastructure we've built on this unstable land is at risk.
The infrastructure that's at risk is also, in some ways, the infrastructure that's causing the problem. Heavy buildings, heavy systems at ports, even rail. These are the infrastructure that is weighing down the land in some cases. It's also the infrastructure that's necessary to keep a region thriving and the thing you need to protect. And unfortunately, our airports are built on fill and are sinking. So it's something that we have to really take seriously, knowing that airports and other critical infrastructure like hospitals and roadways are sinking.
Land subsidence can be mitigated fairly rapidly, particularly those components that are related to human activities.
Every location has a different experience with land subsidence. There are four major categories for mitigating land subsidence. One, collecting water and putting it back in the aquifer, known as recharging. Two, using less water. Three, borrowing water from a neighbor. And four, climate migration.
As aquifers are depleted, land subsides. So if we recharge them, put water back under the ground, aquifers would stop from subsiding or even rise. As a result of that, land subsidence can slow down or completely stop.
This can be helpful for solving other climate issues too.
We can use the water that we have during, for example, wet seasons through flood, collect that and treat that and inject that under the ground and replenish aquifers and keep that water for the rainy days. This case would be our drought years.
These kinds of projects can be some of the most expensive in California, for example.
It costs somewhere between $250 per acre feet of recharge to $1,500 per acre feet of recharge. So you see that huge, and then the median was about, I think, $400 per acre feet of recharge per year. So $400, that's on the median side.
However, managed aquifer recharge is more affordable than other above-ground reservoir solutions, which can cost between 2 to 5 times more. It has other benefits, too.
Managed aquifer recharge is not affected by surface pollution. Water that is underground is not going to evaporate, and water underground would purify itself. When it flows through the porous spaces, the quality increases.
He also suggests using less water or borrowing water from a neighboring city or municipality, though that might be tricky in locations like the West, where multiple communities rely on a limited water source like the Colorado River.
Lastly, communities can consider climate migration strategies, where they move away from or stop building on land dealing with these issues.
Local governments, local industries even need to take this threat seriously and understand where the problems are the greatest. I'm glad this research is coming to light. Not like we need another problem, but it is another problem that we face, and the more that we're aware of it, the more we can do something about it.
In the United States, we have one very successful groundwater management that comes together with land subsidence mitigation. So Orange County, very rapid land subsidence has been observed there, which was tied to the groundwater extraction. So over the past decades, they began deliberately recharging aquifers by using the surplus water that is provided either through rivers or rains or floods. And as early as 2015, land subsidence has been almost mitigated in the region.
The bad news is we're sinking. The good news is we have time to do something about it.